There it goes. Okay. Okay, welcome everyone to the Shooting Game Weekly episode number 83. This is a pretty big one. This is going to be covering the Xevious series in the capacity that we can fill in about an hour and some minutes. And we'll be covering about 4 to 5 of the games, but we'll also be discussing the impact of the Xevious series on the shooting game genre and gaming in general, and talking about the series creator, Masanobu Endo. And so on this stream, myself, Aquas, I am hosting, and I'm joined by my co-host, Frenetic. What's up, Frenetic?
Hey, what's up, Aquas? F-Man in the house. Glad to be back here on STG Weekly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we got Soda streaming for us. So
that's hey! Soda stream here!
It's been a while for that, and we also have a special guest. I'm gonna call him the Xevious enthusiast. It is Eric Twice is joining us to talk about Xevious. You are an official Xevious enthusiast.
Okay.
So yeah, now, welcome to the show, Eric.
Thanks for having me here.
Now, this is a pretty big one for STG Weekly to bring. This is arguably the biggest one that we can talk about, and this is Xevious, and this is the vertically scrolling shooter released by Namco in arcades of December 1982. Ran on the Namco Galaga hardware, and yeah, like I mentioned, designed by Masanobu Endo. Who is also famous for the Tower of Duraga, and Xevious then came into America in 1983. So this game is really old, but kind of the reason we're doing this episode is because I noticed that there was a lack of enthusiasm about the Xevious series in the Western STG community. And so that is why we are here, and we're going to talk about why this is just so important. And actually, you know, the games are actually really fun too, if you spend a little time with them, despite being so old. So why don't we go into just what set apart Xevious when it made its debut in arcades. So if anyone would like to start us off, feel free.
I'll go in. What do you think about that, Eric? Would you like to chime in on that?
Okay. Yeah, it's fine. So you have to think, it's 1982, like every other game, or like 90% of games back in 1982, they were single screen games, like, you know, Robotron or Pac-Man or whatever, you know, very small games with, you know, they mostly center around one or two mechanics, and you just go for a higher score. You know, they are very simple games. And the thing is that suddenly you have Xevious, and Xevious is not a normal arcade game. It's not just getting a higher score, it's about progressing. You have new levels, and each level is different from the other. You have new patterns, you have new enemies. So yeah, it's a very different kind of game from the previous ones. So I think like that's like...
You're very right about that, yeah.
So we saw that this was actually the first shooting game to have a non-space background. And so we have this background, a scrolling background that features forests, paths, and rivers as well. Really just sticking out probably in the arcade like any of the others. So that's a big difference.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Because like, let's say Space Invaders, right? You have all the enemies there at once, and they're not really given any names. They're just assigned point values. You know, there's not a big narrative to the game, correct? And yeah. I think, Eric, you really brought up the fact that what was it like in 1982? I think a lot of people think that this game was created a lot later, you know, like at least 4 or 5 years later, but this came out in 1982.
Yeah, it's true. Mm-hmm. But it's like, you compare with other games, like, you know, it looks normal now, but back in 1982, the graphics and everything was incredible, right? It was like, I mean, this runs on Galaga hardware. I don't know how they did that, but it runs on Galaga hardware. So it was incredible for the time, because you have to imagine like these black screens, like you didn't have a background because it wasn't possible to render it. No. And suddenly you have like this game. Well, it was possible, but not. You know, they have to cheat it out. I don't know how to explain it.
Yeah, I mean, if you see the polish, like Galaga is a great game and Bosconian, but this has such a, like the feeling of movement, right? Of like you're traveling in a world along a landscape. You know, the scrolling of the vertical.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and the enemies, not only the background was unique, but there are 26 unique enemy types that were introduced in Xevious. Another big thing that was introduced were the hidden soul towers. And also the idea of the enemies fearing for their life. We see the enemies here, in this replay, how they approach you, and then as the Solvalo, the Xevious ship, as approaches it, they dart away. And that was an idea that Masanobu Endo was very, very strong about, to give the enemies some kind of, intelligence, essentially. And so we see that too, which is just mind-blowing for the time.
Yeah, actually, like the little tanks, the Grovda, they run away when you target them. So if you just aim right to them, you cannot kill them. You have to predict where they are going to move.
Oh, you have to lead them, because if you put the reticle over them, it warns them that they're getting targeted. Wow, amazing.
And so we see with the soul towers, since you mentioned the reticle, you can find the hidden soul towers by seeing that their reticle starts flashing red to indicate that there's something to target. The reticle will flash red otherwise when you have it hovering over an enemy. There are also special extend flags. However, the reticle will not flash red when hovered over. So these are actually randomly dispersed in some places throughout the game, as I understand. But maybe there's some determined ones as well. So there are these secrets that are in Xevious, which was completely new for the time, and in fact was not what Namco wanted when they were asking for a shooter. A two-button shooter is what they asked for when Xevious was being developed. In fact, during development, he was Endo would kind of do things on kind of. One of the main examples was he said that the soul towers were a bug in the game, and that's how he actually was able to get them into the game. So there's a lot of stuff there.
Yeah,
you guys want to expand on any of that?
So the flags are actually from another Namco game called Rally X. So those S flags with for those extends are from Rally X. I want to add that Masanobu Endo was given sole control over this project, and so he was able to create this Xevious along with, and they were so dedicated, Namco was so dedicated that they created this hardware or modified the existing Galaga hardware for this game in particular. Also, due to Endo being like the sole creator, he was able to put these things in without the consent of the whole corporation, you know, because he's creating he's the artist. And he says, he also said this in a Famitsu interview, you know, when the first prototype was done, his boss told him, this might just become the new standard, so keep going with it. So Endo says, we were trying to create real works of art, not just games. Nowadays, games are treated as more of a service industry than anything else.
That's a pretty big point. Going back a little bit, what happened was his boss, essentially, on the Xevious project left the staff of Xevious, and he was apparently the programmer of the game. So then they left it to Endo to be the head, but he didn't know any programming. He's mostly a sprite artist. And he actually learned programming in 1 month. And after a month of learning, studying programming, he made Xevious, essentially.
That's so amazing.
So, and he was given, like you say, the full creative control in the game. But as an artist, I think that's where the idea for having this full world came in. He's a sprite artist, but he definitely had a vision with the game. He kind of went crazy with it because he was young at the time and really wanted to, you know, just go for it. But the game world part is one of the biggest things that he contributed to the STG scene and just gaming in general, because the idea of a rich background to a game was unheard of completely until that time, as far as I know. I mean, maybe there's an example otherwise, but I'm pretty sure this was it. This was the first way to compare it to an anime or a movie or a similar media.
Yeah, because like most games back then, like had like this very, you know, you had Tapper, you have Logger, you had, you know, all these like very mundane games. Like, you know, it was all very small. The games were made in a few weeks. So, you know, there wasn't like this big idea of let's get like a design document and let's name every single enemy and create a backstory. And so there's just a lot of stuff that it was unheard of back then.
Yes. Now, this is the a quote from a shmuplations.com, a Xevious collection of interviews that was actually recently posted. And we'll be sending some information from this, but it's a very nice interview. I'd like to read this full quote from Masanobu Endo because it characterizes exactly what he did. So Masanobu says, "What I wanted to try doing with Xevious was, for the first time, to give a video game a consistent world and setting, also within the limitations of the existing hardware. I wanted to create high quality sprites. Finally, I wanted a story that wouldn't just be some tacked on extra, but could actually stand on its own merits. This experiment, if you will, was a totally new way to approach making a game. It was closer to the way anime and movie creators think. As a result, it resonated with the anime generation, and Xevious, which had actually been somewhat contentious title within Namco, ushered in a new wave of video games. A less public result was that after Xevious, the culture of game magazines like Beep also grew rapidly. So he created a phenomenon in video games."
Yeah, like something he said, like the magazines, like this was a big deal because, you know, there used to be like always this kind of exchange of strategy and tips and small stuff. But, you know, it was there. It was only if you wanted to be good. But if you want to, you know, find the soul towers, if you want to beat the boss, like, there's more to talk about in Xevious than in other games of the era. Like, so.
Mm.
So I think that was something that also, like, tied in the whole thing of the creating a world. Like, it's also discussing what was created, and I think this was also, will also be like very important for the Tower of Druaga.
Yes.
So.
Yeah.
I think it's like the basic came from here.
Yeah. Exactly. So Tower of Druaga would go on to start the notebook arcade culture, where people would start to, like writing notes down about the games and. Really, yeah, that aspect of discussion in the arcades, I think, probably started happening around then. I think because you had the stigma of, you know, arcades being for delinquents at that time, I would imagine still. So to have, you know, people talking about, you know, maybe delinquents, maybe antisocialness was tied to it at the same time as well. It's hard to say, not having experienced it, but. Surely there's probably some aspect of that there.
So, okay, yeah. Speaking of story...
Yeah, why don't we go into the story then?
Yeah, so we're talking about the rich story. So I have here the Xevious 3D G+ manual that came for the PlayStation. So I'm going to quickly summarize the story of Xevious. and you'll find it's just really a deep story. So the enemies in Xevious are known as the GAMP, which is short for Genetic Artificial Matrix Producer. This is a biocomputer which mass produce like clones that to serve man.
Correct.
So this happened 100 millennium ago when humankind was capable of producing amazing technologies. So basically, what time started to pass and the GAMP started to experience these, get corrupted by the replication, there was errors. And so they started to have a will of their own, but they started to grow slowly insane because they were just kind of created to be slaves and their brains couldn't handle this new information, these corruptions. So their mission to protect humanity gets perverted, and they started to think themselves as superior, and then they enslave the humans. And then basically... Now,
and this happens over the course of like 100,000 years or so.
Yeah, the scope is just amazing. Like probably as large as Endo's vision for the game Xevious, you know, he's just going out there. So basically humans get moved to different worlds, M-class planets all across the universe. Then what happens is the Ice Age comes on Earth, okay? And then the humans finally are able to rebel against the GAMPs. And then the GAMPs are destroyed, but the humans are left on Earth. Then, thousands of years later, Ice Age comes, and then humanity rebuilds. And what happens is there's actually seismic activity on Earth, and it starts to awaken these embedded GAMP bases that were left over from the war. And then, so the GAMP reawakens, and then we get to our protagonist, which is Moo, a brave pilot, and Eve, his android assistant, and are sent to a mission to Xevious to make contact with the human ancestors in order to save them from this catastrophe. Mm. And then after that,
yeah,
more. They're trying to go to Xevious. Now, time is passing relatively for Moo and Eve. So, in the meantime, back on Earth, is humans come back as an advanced civilization, of course, and then they reawaken the GAMP base on the Nazca Plateau of Peru. Basically, those lines that you see in Peru, those drawings, and they reawaken a GAMP base. So. Then Moo and Eve come back and have to fight the reawakened menace. So yeah, it just goes on and on and on, and it's just an amazing story.
It's pretty cool. What it reminds me most of is the Phantasy Star series to me, where you have that kind of sci-fi element there, and it's really cool. And yeah, there's a novel that was written based off of this. Also an anime and a movie, as I understand.
yeah.
And actually, I think it's not one book, it's three different books, 200 or 300 pages each. It's
wow.
So, and this is not you only see this very, very small part in the game, and then you have lots of stuff that was created, but it was there's this huge backstory which we are not going to cover now.
It wasn't half-assed either, that's the thing. It just truly set the standard for future releases, and then we started, basically some of the one of the next main examples of game worlds that would expand would be the levels in Gradius and Darius, and you'd see just how much character those levels started to give to those games. And as arcade culture grew, of course, you'd have these arcade flyers that would just be very anime-like. And truly, we really have Xevious to thank for just video games being basically more regarded as an art form, which is really awesome. So that covers kind of the story a bit. What else do we want to talk about, Masanobu Endo or the release of the arcades? Perhaps we could get to our memories of Xevious now, too.
Okay.
Any lingering thoughts? Okay, let's go. Well, okay, we got a few different memories of Xevious, our experiences with Xevious, so I'm going to throw it to Eric twice. What is your fond memory of Xevious?
Like, the funniest thing is, like, back when I was, like, 5 or 6 or, you know, way back in the day, like, I played Xevious with my cousin, and it was like, you know, just a game you play when you are a kid and you don't really care. But like 20 years later, like 5 years ago or something like that, I was like, you know, I still really like play Xevious again because it's a really important game historically and stuff. And I wasn't like really looking forward to it. It was more like, you know, I'm going to play this because it's important, not because it's actually interesting or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And actually, like, my first impression was like, oh, you know, this is really slow. This is very rigid. And, you know, like, the usual perception that people have now. But after a while, like, it starts to click, like, you start to realize it's not... Like, there's far more to it than meets the eye, like... Mm-hmm. Like, for example, like, at first you say, you know, this is, like, really slow, even, like, for the time. But then you realize, like, you have to go to specific places to shoot. Because the enemies are going to fly away. It's not like you can just go and kill everyone. It's just... So, you know, you start to think and you start to focus on the game. And I don't know. I think, like, it's again, like, my appreciation for it has grown stronger over time. It was not a game I like at first.
Yeah. Cool. Like, for me, like, I don't recall really... having it leave a mark on me as a child or anything. I may have played it once or something, or seen it, but I don't know. I saw it at a Xevious cabinet in a Baskin Robbins ice cream place like a few years ago, and I played it, and the arcade cabinet only had a 4-way joystick, so I could not actually do diagonals. It also only had one button. So you could not use the blaster.
Tell me it was the zapper and not the blaster, right?
Yeah, so the zapper is your main shot, and then the blaster is the little bomb thing. It didn't have the blaster.
Oh,
wow.
So I was just going around. I was trying to go around four-way.
Did you try to, like, time out Andor Genesis or something?
I even got that far, but it was pretty funny. I think it might have been my first time playing the arcade version at that time. But it was just like, but at that time, that was after the fact that I knew, like, shmups were something I was super interested in. So when I saw the Xevious cabinet, I instantly, like, went over to it. And then people were like, oh, he's playing the Xevious. Because I was with a whole bunch of people. Like, it was like a mini vacation or something like that. But in any case. Yeah, so what are your memories, Frenetic?
I remember playing this game, like, in Pizza Hut when I was young, and just kind of like, oh, wow, this is kind of neat. And, the cabin is very interesting because I think they put, like, a plexiglass over it, and the cabinet is a work of art on its own as well. So flash forward about maybe 2 or 3 years ago when I was living in, actually probably just 2 years ago when I was living in I went to a clothing store, kind of this boutique clothing store for Long Beach. It was called like a Long Beach Clothing Company or something, or like the 510 or 310 or something. Anyways, so I go, and there's a Xevious cabinet in there, and I got super excited, and then I went over to it, and it was turned off. I have this horrible luck with finding shmup cabinets in the wild. I found a Pro Gear cabinet that was like a converted JoJo Bizarre Adventure on the Queen Mary's arcade, and I was like, yeah, I've won all this game, I'm gonna play this here in the arcade, and it was shut off as well. So yeah, someone there's taunting me going like, you need to revive us, Frenetic. So that's my memory.
Yeah, they are begging you to take them home, like, please repair us, live with us forever. Spent hundreds of dollars repairing us.
Yeah, resurrect us. And I was like, I'll just make this happen.
Okay, so I think we can kind of transition now into talking about the replay that we're actually witnessing, and just also adding some more that we have any leftover thoughts about the release of Xevious. That we have a couple more points I think we can hit here, but so what we're looking at right here is a counter stop in the progress of a counter stop video of Xevious. Now, so this is from the cafemakaimura channel on YouTube. Now, interestingly, Xevious, the original Xevious, was counter stopped in arcades only 2 weeks into the release. When this happened, the player, in fact, met with Endo, and just because Endo was just so shocked that you know that had happened so quickly. The counter stop, I imagine, I mean, this video, it goes on for like 6 hours or so. It's like an 8 hour thing or something, probably even longer than that. But anyway, so the player met with Endo, and basically they just talked a little bit, and they watched the replay together. And then the player then asked Endo if he could publish a strategy guide for Xevious. And this was probably one of the first video game strategy guides that was ever circulated. And it was probably just circulated within the arcade circles at the time. So then a guide was made. So yeah, we're just taking a look at Xevious here. So let's talk a bit about just the gameplay itself. Let's see, he's got something like 20 lives, some 10 lives right now. I think it's not even counting them even further, but we've also got a lot of bullets on screen. So he's very far into the game. So the rank seems to be a bit higher than usual, I would say. This looks very crazy compared to like the beginning of the game right now. But yeah, so like with the gameplay, which is very cool, it's very hypnotic. Like you have the paths on the landscape, and often on those paths you have the tanks that will follow them. So that will give you a cue of kind of where you should be. And we talked about like kind of having a little bit of a route to follow. And so the game guides you, guides you with the enemy placements and that type of thing. And so it's just a very kind of hypnotic gameplay. Would any of you like to expand on that?
Yeah, what I think is that you have to consider, like, it's like the first map, so it's not really quite like a modern game, and it really feels like sometimes closer to Galaga or other games of the time. Like the kind of movement, the kind of, you have to be there so you can meet the plane that is coming down and then shoot it. So you have like this very, I'm going here, then I'm killing them, then I'm moving, and it's like, as you say, like really hypnotic, like you are moving and getting into the rhythm of the game. So it's
Yeah, and so where the reticle is, you actually can't fly above, you actually can't get the reticle off of the top of the screen. So where the reticle meets the screen, you can't actually fly up there. And so they were still kind of, it was still a fresh idea to have this free movement. But with the movement, it becomes important to remember that you actually move faster going left and right instead of diagonally up left and up right. And that's actually quite a difference. So there'll be times in the game where you actually do need to focus on just moving left and right to actually get more movement speed, which is, it actually really, really, really plays into it. So why don't we talk about some of these enemy types?
We have two different types of targets. So two different planes of attack. So we have, you know, the airborne enemies, which you can kill with the zapper or the shot. And then we have the ground targets, which you can destroy with the blaster, which is also known as the bomb button. Correct me if I'm wrong, but from playing Xevious, the enemies that are airborne do shoot at you, but not a lot. But the priority is for the ground targets that shoot at you, which are like the chill ones, the are called lograms or sphere stations. But some of the other ones, which are like that shoot at you a lot, which are the they're called the Dorotas. They're kind of, they look like mini it's funny because like the units like evolve into looking like Andor Genesis, right? They have this weird organic, like that they all have this common theme to it, with which is really amazing too. Like you have to shoot from the core, the center.
Yeah. Then Andor Genesis is one of like the first bosses of gaming as well. We'll probably see him in a bit. So in the replay, he just took out an enemy that's really annoying. It's like this big bomb that kind of appears, and if you don't shoot it right away, it just kind of explodes and then has this like super fast spread shot that comes down. And it's really hard to avoid. There's also a bit of RNG on where that enemy will appear. So if it's on the left side and you're on the right side, you're probably going to have to deal with dodging it. And first time players are probably going to get wrecked by that enemy quite a bit. It's like this big ball. You see a lot of different enemy types, and it's really important to remember what they all do. Because if you don't remember what they all do, you're probably gonna get owned. Like these black ones right now, for example, they float down, and then at any time when they're floating down, they can explode and then shoot a bullet at you. So at any time they're floating down, so you have to make sure that if any of them is gonna be getting past your ship, it could explode like in the kind of snipe you from the side. And so that's super annoying.
It's funny.
There's that enemy I was talking about.
They're called Zakato, and as you know from like certain kind of popcorn enemies that are known in the Japanese language, they're known as like Zako. So even though that they're known as like popcorn or kind of insignificant enemies, like if you don't take care of them right away, it can get really crazy, especially with the Brag and the Garu Zakato, which they explode into smaller pieces and more shrapnel, and then they'll explode into other bullets that you can't destroy.
Yeah, I think like what you said earlier is more like you have like a static target, and it's like you have to destroy that, and if you don't, other flying enemies are going to trap you in a corner or something, just so you really have to, you know, get into the middle of everything and kill the Bothalogram or this kind of big structures, because otherwise you're going to get trapped, and I think that's what gives the game character. So.
You're totally right. Like, you have to get up and bomb the ground enemies because they're shooting at you so much. But at the same time, because the flying enemies will provide support and like will kill you or ram into you, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So you kind of end up like kind of choreographing your left and right sweeps as you're playing, and with the knowledge of where the ground targets are, I think.
Yeah, you're moving up actually into the middle of the screen to kill the ground enemies, because or else they'll fill the screen with bullets, especially in the later levels. You can kind of see that.
Yeah, this enemy type that shoots a lot of bullets at you and then flies away. It's kind of like a modification of the first Zakodo, which is the more fierce version there.
And look how it is when they have those indestructible plaques. You know, they're called... let's go look this up real quick. You know,
the mirrors.
Usually you can shoot, they're called Bakura, or called the resistor shield. And to have something indestructible, like in a shmup, it's almost like having environment, you know, which you will see in Gradius later. So all these elements of shmups, shooting games, are like here in Xevious.
Yeah.
In one form or another.
It's truly amazing once you get to know the game a bit. Like you find out it has a lot of those elements that we've all like discovered from playing various modern games, essentially, I think.
Yeah, like many enemy types, they are like the basics of shmups. Like practically every game in the general, like, they have like this bomber that goes to the middle of the screen, drops bombs, and then leaves. Like every single one of them. Like you have them in Battle Garriga, you have them in Dangan Feveron. Like every single game has them, and it's like, and it's here. You know, it's kind of the basic enemy here, and I think that's really interesting.
Yeah, they even have like the enemies that come from behind and like the fear, you know, tanks that like move and track your movement and stay on the screen instead of like, you know, moving off, so you have to kill it really soon. It's amazing how much is put in this game. Very jam-packed.
And if you ever do spend a decent amount of time with this game, like, there's that hypnotic element really also comes from that background music. We don't have it going right now, but it's everyone knows it. It's the very iconic doodly 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 doo.
Can you do that again for us?
No.
I'll do it then. Doodly 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 doo.
Well, anyway, yeah, I mean, that people complain about that track, but it's actually, I think, super well designed, because there could be a more annoying loop, I think, than what they created there. But I really like it, though.
Yeah, you know, we are laughing, but this was actually the very first video game soundtrack ever released. Like, that, well, it wasn't that loop, it was like a modification, but a group of musicians who really liked the game. But it was the first CD, and so you could buy like this very annoying loop, a CD of that. And that was the very first music CD for a video game ever. It's like, wow.
That's another milestone, definitely. Oh man, so yeah, Xevious 1, it's a crazy game. It has 16 areas, and then after 16 areas, they begin to repeat endlessly. And then you have Andor Genesis on the screen right now. He appears 4 times per loop, every 4 stages or so. So he just appears. You can time him out, or you can go in for a kill, can risk your life a little bit and try to get some extra points. But yeah, I think that's gonna probably cover Xevious 1. We can probably start getting into some of the other games. Oh geez, was there anything else we're forgetting to mention? Xevious was also the first video game to be advertised as a commercial in the United States. That's another like little factoid there. What are some other little things that we should mention before we move on here?
I think that's it. Like, the only thing I don't think we have mentioned, like, it was one of the first game designed, you know, with the player experience in mind of like, is this too difficult, is this too hard? Like, games weren't really playtested that much back in the day.
Oh, okay.
So if you reach like the 70% of the stage and you die, you don't repeat it, you go to the next stage.
Oh yeah, that's a big deal, yeah.
And that's a big deal, because it's very frustrating, you know. Imagine, like, this was the first game in which you die and then you have to repeat and then you have to repeat. So it's a way of trying to avoid that kind of frustration. So I think that's also, like, something very small but also very important.
The lenient checkpoint system is definitely a big help. I mean, I'm sure that could have been that could have even been the breaking point for the success of this game in arcades.
Yeah. And also, like, you know, when we talk about, you know, the SMAP community and everything about memorizers and, you know, making a strategy, like, this was all born in this game. Like, every single, like, most creators of, you know, SMAP games and everything, like, they say that, you know, we used to create strategies for Xevious, and now that we make our games, we are going to do something like that. Like, in to our plan, they say this, like, you can dig the interviews and stuff, and they say, oh yeah, I used to be a very good player of Xevious, and I love how I had to, you know, get into this corner and then move there. So that's why you get like Traxton. If you play Traxton, I think it's this like kind of Xevious like habit.
So you have like this idea of like a route, essentially.
Yeah, exactly.
First appearing here. Yeah, Xevious, it's amazing. Definitely give it a shot. So we're going to move on then to, we're going to actually be taking a look at a couple other games. So there was a lot of different games in the Xevious series. A lot of them, in fact. It was, probably about 10 or so of them, but we're not going to be covering all of them. After Xevious, there was a Super Xevious released in 1984, and that was this pretty much the same game, but made significantly harder. They added some new enemies. An enemy would reset the score if you destroyed it. There was some enemies you could rescue, or I mean, people think there was like a target you could rescue as well in Super Xevious. We're not going to be showing this, however. We're going to move straight to Xevious Arrangement, which is a very excellently redesigned version of Xevious that was released in 1995 in arcades, around the same time that Xevious 3D/G was released, which we'll be getting to as well. So this is the next big update, and the update that I find to be one that fixes a lot of the issues with Xevious that some players may complain about. Before I get into that, let's begin the arrangement replay, I suppose. So let's queue that up. I should probably wait till Frenetic. Okay, Frenetic's back. Great. Frenetic, we're going to queue up the arrangement video now.
Oh, awesome. Gotcha.
Okay, and so just a little preface here. This is some footage I personally recorded for the episode because there was no good Xevious arrangement footage. So this is just me playing a few credits to Area 14. We're probably not going to watch all of it, but we'll watch some of it as we talk about how this version differs. Okay, 3, 2, 1, go. And so I'm playing this on the Xevious 3D/G PlayStation release, which has pretty much all the games that we're talking about on this particular episode, conveniently enough. And it's on the PlayStation Network. Hint, hint, buy that.
Wow, cool. Yes, buy it.
Yeah, so Xevious 3D/G, this release was actually put onto the PlayStation Network only about 4 months ago now, 5 months ago. This is a recent PlayStation Network release. Very cool. In any case, so about Xevious Arrangement, a few different changes you'll see, you'll hear right away is that music was rearranged by Shinji Hozo and Ayako Sasso, both really legendary video game music composers. They rearranged the soundtrack. They gave, they kind of made it like a full like DJ mix. So as you go through the game, each area kind of has a different feel, and then it changes after every end or genesis you discover. Also, one of the main gameplay changes is the ship will move faster. You move a bit faster than the original Xevious. Also, you're able to use the blaster, aka the bomb. You're able to shoot those bombs out quite a bit quicker. And the reticle is brought closer to the Salvalo as well. So all of these changes end up making for a more fast-paced version of Xevious, which I find to be very fun.
It's really, really fast. Like, it doesn't look like it now. It's like, you know, a bit faster, but after a while it gets really, really fast.
Now, you also have an introduction of a power-up item, so it makes your shot just a little bit wider. Also changes the sound effect. Thank you. So yeah, Area 2.
You know what's really awesome about that item? It looks like the Sheonite, which is you can't destroy in the first Xevious. So it's like this ultimate defensive troop in Xevious, but then you're able to get it and use it as a offensive weapon. I find that really fascinating in the arrangement mode.
Yeah, it's true. I didn't notice that.
Okay, we have someone chiming in the chat saying the music was actually by some different people. Huh, okay, well, Takayuki Aihara and Masahiro Fukuzawa. Well, in any case, there was a lot of artists on this project, because in the soundtrack there's arrangements and like original versions, and I don't know, there's a lot of people. But anyway, back to what we were saying.
So what I think is that if you are like, you know, yeah, you are telling me a lot of cool stuff, but I still don't like the game, you have to try this one. Like, this is like if you like maps, you are going to like this game. It's like far more in taste with what normal, you know, the average player wants to in a game. but it's Xevious, so it has like both parts, and I think that's nice.
I think it just brings the flavor of Xevious to you a bit better than Xevious does. I think to put it that way. And so I just get crushed by the backward scrolling Bakura.
The defensive shield becomes an offensive shield now. Oh.
Yeah, the first time that happens, like, you die. It's like, you don't expect it at all. You are like, you know.
I also wanted to call
build.
Attention.
This is like the old Xevious.
Go ahead, Frenetic.
Oh, sorry to interrupt, Eric. I just wanted to interject that you could see the power-ups as he was getting, like, it started doubling the points or adding 2,000 to the points, like 2,000 and then 4,000 once he got the power-up, so... A little bit of meddling, so to say, there.
Yeah, you can get that up to 10k points. You also find the special hit extend flag somewhere, but I still don't know the secret to getting it, and I refuse to look at the strategy wiki, which reveals the secret, because I'm just, like, stubborn, and I really want to discover it on my own.
Well, that, you're like, no spoilers.
But no spoilers, that's the best please. Part, because... Like, I know it, and I see you playing the game, and I'm like, and I see you thinking, I don't know if she's going to be here, or she's going to be there, and I'm like, yep, she's not going to find it.
yeah, one of these days, I'll figure it out.
And it's important, because...
So, just about...
Oh, no, never mind, but just wanted to say that you need to find them, or at least the soul towers, if you want to see like the true ending of the game. So it's an important part now, it's not just points.
I always love the kind of siren that plays when Endor Genesis appears. Like, that is just freaking epic.
This is crazy.
Like, listen to that sound. It sounds like fucking alien shit. I'm very eloquent right now. But yeah, so I'm like taking out the parts there for extra points, and then he just stops. But yeah, so like in the arrangement, you have the enemy types really being cycled on you constantly. So like right just in the fucking 8 seconds there, those like four different enemy types. And you gotta remember what all their behaviors are, because if you kind of slip on that, like, one something will slip by and get you. Like, for example, like, you know, when some of those guys, when they get next to you, they fire at you. Well, if you don't actually get next to them, they won't fire at you, but if you get next to them way too late and then they fire at you, they could snipe you. So it's like, all these different things to remember.
No ceiling in here, right?
There is ceiling, in fact, actually. You gotta get pretty close to some targets. Some ground targets do not seal, and some do. So you gotta keep that in mind as well, because
something
you can't have a jerk.
Definitely important to remember.
Like something we didn't say before, like this game was the first game that had rank in it. Like, you know, adaptive difficulty and stuff, and it was the first one. And it not only gets harder if you kill more enemies, like if you are very good at killing one kind of enemy, the game learns about it and says, oh, okay, I'm going to you know, send another kind of enemy to fight you.
Yeah.
And in the original game is not like that important, but in arrangement is. Like, you can really tell that it goes after you.
It gets brutal. The worst enemy type, in my opinion, is the one that kind of floats down. They can explode at any moment and shoot you, but when they explode, they shoot a spread shot, which really limits your movement. I fucking hate them.
There's a very special part of Xevious, and it's that they make Aquas like really, really, really salty.
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
he can play Ghosts and Goblins, he can play Gimmick, but he plays Xevious and he rages. It's like, wow, what the fuck, this game?
Yeah, I don't know, I got the bug, it's good stuff, but yeah, like, this, it'll make you pissed, for sure. Like, and it's part of the how the enemy is, like, they just kind of react to you, it's crazy. And it's because when I play, I don't hold back on destroying any of the targets, so... the game just throws everything at me, and then it's just like, whatever. I just kind of deal with it. When you die in arrangement, noticeably the rank will go down. But so like in the original Xevious, yeah, you had actually a specific enemy type called the Detector Dome. I think it's actually one of the ones you might see on the screen
right now. Yeah, is that the red?
The red one there?
Circle that is not destroyed, that one.
Yeah, that one. Yeah, so when you destroy them, it actually reduces the difficulty of the game. So you can actually go through and, you know, select which enemies you're going to pick and make sure you actually take care of those guys to keep the difficulty down a little bit. But yeah, the difficulty ramps up and it almost gets bullet hell-esque, even in the original Xevious. It's funny too, they say bullet hell when you talk about old school shooters, but it truly was the reality because the hitbox was bigger, and just it's the only difference was that the hitbox was bigger and that you moved a bit slower and bullets just filled the screen. Like there, for example, like I just got through that somehow. I don't know, you know, but that's how epic Xevious gets sometimes. Anyway, so we're already about 10 minutes to his replay and. Or almost probably approaching about the hour mark of this, so we have some other stuff to check out, but yeah, the music's also wonderful in Arrangement as well. So if you play Arrangement on the PlayStation, you're able to select an Arranged soundtrack or the original. So right now I'm actually playing with the Arranged soundtrack, and it's really nice. You have like this kind of cool new mid boss here. But yeah, so then in Arrangement, there's two extra areas after Area 16. Goes up to Area 18, and then I think it ends. I don't remember.
Or at least loops. So in the PlayStation version, you can actually tape, which is really cool. They really thought about a lot of this game, you know.
The PlayStation really release cool. is excellent. It's super excellent. Yeah, look at all those bullets. Like, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, they just like, one, like, all the time. It reminds me, like, again, in Battle Garriga, like, when you have, like, these big planes that shoot, like, a stream of bullets, and you only have, like, a very small space to go through. It's kind of like that.
Yeah. Yeah, you definitely, you know. Go ahead.
There's not like a where you can take a breath, you know, like the breaths are shorter. Like when you're playing a piece of music, it's like, all right, gotta do this. Like in different Caravan games, it's like wave. But these overlap. Like I think with like a ground enemy, right? So it's like airborne enemy, then a ground enemies like appear on the screen. Did you see that? Like you finish killing the ground enemies and then airborne enemies come in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and they come for you. It's like, oh yeah, now that you are closer to the top of the screen, you get like the bombers that get to the middle and shoot one bullet, like really well made. There.
Like there, like I had to mind all the air stuff, so I had to dodge it on the right. But then I had to also make sure to do that at the right time so that I could actually cut left and get those ground targets. So it's like, yeah, you start to develop like a nice route and it's, oh man, so good. And the music's just like bumping, like, the arrangement's really nice. But yeah, I think we can move on from Arrangement.
Yeah, that sounds good. The only thing sad about Namco games and where Arrangement appears on is they are flipped wrongly on... for tape mode, so you have to like rewire your cab's yoke mode to flip it the correct way.
That's
the only thing. So, little bit of arcade hardware trivia for you.
Okay, so that'll do it for Xevious Arrangement. I just make it to Area 14. It's nothing too special, and I just credit fed. The game gives you 3 credits on default, and then after that, you're done. So, the farthest I've made it was Area 16, and dude, the fucking boss is insane on Area 16. It's like, imagine like a Casio keyboard shooting like a billion bullets at you. That's what it's like.
He's right, you know.
Oh my god, it's mind blowing. But I don't know if I'll ever beat it. But yeah, so we're going to be moving on now to Xevious 3D/G, which is the main title on this PlayStation release, released in 1995 of arcades. So they brought the title to 3D. They changed quite a few things. This game is more of a perspective shmup. You have the perspective changing in a lot of situations to really emphasize the fact that the game is 3D, and I really love it for the perspective shifts. You also have three powers that are unique. There's a spread shot which starts out as the original zapper, but then can upgrade into a spread shot, which is a blue weapon. Then you have a red weapon, which is a kind of serpentine seeking laser, multiple seeking lasers. Then you also have a green weapon, which is a straightforward green powerful laser. Xevious 3D is insanely difficult game. Also very, very cool. So let's get into the replay so we can start discussing it. Now, this is a super play, and this is an amazing, amazing replay. So you guys are in for a treat on this. This game is probably, in my experience, one of the hardest shoot 'em ups I've ever played. So the fact that this guy rips this game a new one is just freaking crazy. All right, so you know, I think what I was talking about with Shinji Hoso and Ayako Sasso, I think they did the music for the 3D game. That's where I went wrong there earlier. So apologies about that. But yeah, they did do the music for the 3D one, and it's pretty cool. So let's get into it. Starting from zero, countdown: 3, 2, 1, go. Instantly, it dropped down from like a aircraft carrier.
Goes after soul towers right away.
No, yeah. So the you still have the rank increase from destroying stuff, but specifically the soul towers. When you unveil and destroy them, it increases the difficulty of the game right away. Like, and then as you destroy more of them, it gets even crazier. And there's a lot of them too. So you'll see a lot of them.
Oh, did you see the little Easter egg? Wow.
He got the Easter egg that shows who programmed it there.
I'm definitely getting some Eschatos feel on this, you know?
Yeah, it kind of has that. We didn't touch on it earlier, but Endo was also one of the first... He was someone who really thought that games shouldn't be known as like a Capcom or a Konami game when referenced, but rather a game by a certain designer. And he really wanted that to be the feel, but unfortunately it didn't carry on still to this day. We still think of games like Konami games or Capcom games, etc.
No, like, you have to think, like back then there was no credits anywhere. Like, not in the cap, and there was no database, there was nothing. And the funny thing is that Endo calls himself a game designer. He didn't call himself a programmer, like most. You know, like most other people, and he was like really intense about it. Like, for example, Miyamoto, he talked with Miyamoto and told him to come out and say, you know, I design Super Mario, I'm a game designer. So it's he was very important for the people he knew. He was influential on a personal level. So
Shigeru Miyamoto, of course.
Yeah. And also, like, for example, like the Easter egg is just the name of the designer. And that's also a very small thing, but for example, Yu Suzuki in OutRun, he does the same thing. And for the same reason, it was like a bit of the way to, you know, to credit yourself in your game. Because back then you couldn't, you still can.
I mean, I don't blame him, you know, like... These games are badass, like, you want to be recognized for it, right?
Yeah, especially in Japanese culture, where the nail that sticks up gets hammered down, you know? It's an amazing thing that they'll put it in, and they didn't get fired for it, or it's crazy.
They would do things behind the heads' backs sometimes, and just kind of not mention it, or you know, the arcades were the Wild West of gaming in that respect. So yeah, you had a lot of stuff that happened. So yeah, Xevious 3D here, it's pretty cool looking.
Yeah, the thing that surprised me about Xevious 3D is that the first time you look, you say like, it's very bland looking at first, and you think like it's very soft and normal, but then you start playing it and it gets hard, and it starts to, you know, press your buttons.
It does.
Again, it's really hard. It doesn't look like it, but it's really, really hard. Like, now it's fine, but after a while it starts to... And it's not obvious, like, you get killed, like, every single enemy can kill you. There are not... None of those guys that you see flying around, they are not popcorn enemies. They are going to kill you a lot of the time.
Yeah, and you get to see, like, you kind of get deceived by a lot of, you get deceived by the difficulty level. It's like the game has something, a surprise for you, and if you're not ready for it, well, you're done. This boss is pretty annoying. He has a lot of turrets attached to him. Also has these flying enemies in the beginning. But if you take too long to kill him, it gets kind of out of hand. This guy's got a really good strategy. Just goes for the core and gets him taken out right away. But if you ever watch me stream this game, I fight this boss for like 30 to 40 seconds and end up usually cursing by the end of it.
You are cursing for the whole duration of the game. Like, you started and like in 10 minutes you are just yelling at everything. Like, every single enemy is... I don't know. It's very fun to watch him play.
Unfortunately, you won't see the other weapons during this replay. Turns out the spread shot is the most effective weapon. But the red weapon is interesting. It's a bunch of kind of snake-like lasers that lock onto enemies, and it upgrades to it adds extra lasers as you upgrade it. But the interesting perk about it is that it will search out the hidden soul towers for you, so you actually won't need to search for them. But then the drawback to that is if you're using the red weapon exclusively, you probably don't want to destroy all those soul towers you're finding because the game will just get super mad at you. And so there's that drawback there, because the red weapon ends up not having nearly enough power to take out some enemies that become a threat at a certain point.
And yeah. This part, we got a second because it's going too fast, it looks like very easy and very simple, but it's actually quite hard because you have to destroy those targets and they are also moving. So they push you to the corner of the screen and then the guys from the top just pin you down and kill you. So it's like, it's nastier than it looks. It's just, I think like, I'm not a great SMAP player, and when I play it, I feel like, oh, you know, I'm getting killed, but I don't quite know why. But then I sit and say, like, they are cornering me.
Yeah, and the perspective really screws with you, too, sometimes. That will definitely play a factor, because with the perspective, you'll perceive the bullet to be traveling a certain way, when in fact it's in space a different way. And that becomes a different challenge, a unique challenge. Some consider the perspective stuff to be more annoying than cool, but I always enjoy it because it really feels like you're part of the action when the camera is shifting around and kind of keeping you feeling like you're kind of following along, like you're part of it. But yeah, I love the graphics. I think the graphics really held up in this game. Like, the approach is a good one. They kept the graphics simple, but the style is intact. And that was really the best way to approach PlayStation graphics, I think. They hold up.
Yeah, and if you look at I've seen the game in the arcade. And it looks far better in the arcade if you have a CRT, because it's soft and stuff, but it's easier on the eyes than, you know, just the PlayStation on an LCD screen, so.
I see. got a question about the hitbox. So the hitbox is pretty much the whole ship. I mean, that's pretty much. I would say maybe not the very tips of the wings, but it's pretty much the whole ship. He's got a nice strategy for this boss. I mean, this guy is... His YouTube name is like Mr. Something, so he refers to himself as Mr. So this guy is legit.
He's the kind of guy, like, you have seen, like, in the Toaplan shooters, like, the kind of guy that sticks to the front of the screen and just murders everything before they come. Is that kind of guy. And then you play yourself and you get killed, like, left, right.
Now, this stage really will bust your... will grind your gears, bust your bubbles, really make you piss. I'm just traumatized by this game, everyone. It's so brutal. This stage is so brutal. Like, you have to be on top of everything. Like, otherwise it just becomes utter chaos. Those little guys, like little spider guys, kind of going around. Like, they're really annoying. They move like kind of randomly, and they shoot aimed bullets at you. You'll see. This guy's gonna handle it nicely, but. You'll see just how stupid this gets, and just how awesome this guy plays. He has some really nice dodges. So here's a special extend flag here. So he triggers a special extend flag for a 1-up there. I'm still not 100% sure how it works, but it's somewhere around there. You need to take out those soul towers. I think it has something to do with that. Those three mid-sized enemies there, you have to take those out like immediately. They fire in like a random, like they spin around and they just fire in random directions and their bullets are quick. So it's just like, you're just reacting. Like this is very much so like a very twitch based type of shooter. You're oftentimes reacting to what's happening and making some really, really fast decisions on where to be. And you just have to be very, very like smooth and when you cut back and that type of thing. Due to the perspective being strange, it doesn't help either when you're trying to cut through some bullets.
Yeah, I think something that kills you in this game is like you focus on one enemy and you like for a millisecond you forget about other enemy on the screen. Yeah. And that guy kills you. It's like and they like the game knows this. It's what they are trying to do that. They are trying to get you to focus on one part so they can kill you from the side.
It's evil. It's evil, everyone. Like, this is for like expert players, I think. This is like the Tatsujin of Xevious, essentially. Because that's what they do with Super Xevious, and then they made this 3D game, and it's just so brutal.
Yeah, like, it was made, like, you have to imagine, like, back when this game was released, there were people who had been playing Xevious for 10 years straight. Yes. So it was like, you know, let's just make it super hard, because reasons.
Because they knew the Xevious players were hardcore. Yeah, they knew. They knew, so they made a hardcore game for them. I love this stage. This stage is so cool looking. It's a snow stage at kind of like at night. You have the water reflecting at nighttime. So cool. And the snow looks fucking epic. Fuck yes, man. Fuck yes.
I just love how, you know, like, you really hate the game, but love it at the same time.
Yeah, it's definitely a love-hate relationship.
Yeah, you have an abusive relationship with the game.
Yeah.
It's not good for you, man.
You have these glaciers going around. Fucking like Titanic is about to happen. Oh, there's like a cool little that's a cool little point trick there. I actually didn't know you could do that. There's like a little enemy he point blank there. So he actually dies here, which is interesting, so you get to see recovery. Recovery is super difficult in this game, by the way. Super difficult.
As far as insane, like you have like all those pieces of ice with I mean, it doesn't even make sense. Like, there are turrets and enemies in a small piece of ice for no apparent reason. It's just there.
Yeah, that's... Yeah, it really does not make sense.
Just screw you over.
Diabolically planned against you.
Yeah, I mean, the actual reason is that they are on the ground and, you know, like 100,000 years later, they come out and they are in the middle of nowhere. Because the whole continents have changed and everything.
Oh, sure.
But I still think it's just to screw you up, of course.
Yeah. And you have some of the original Xevious enemy types returning as well in 3D. So they really kept it true to the feel as well. It's a really interesting sequel.
I think it's less, like, if you really want to start with Arrangement, which I think is, like, the most normal game.
Yeah.
And this is more like, you know, you like this kind of game, this is, like, the game that is going to press your buttons, mm-hmm. that kind of stuff. Wow, this guy kills the boss, like, in 10 seconds.
Yeah, he's got some really good strats.
It's ultra hard.
Yeah, I'm going to be stealing a lot of these strats next time I play this game, because this was my first time seeing this replay. Not now, but before we did this episode. Yeah, now there's an epic FMV for going into space, a la like the Raiden space cutscene. They have one in here too. Definitely appreciated. And then there's these epic space stages now. Bringing it full circle.
Yeah, like Endo said back when he made the game, that he said that if he ever made a sequel himself, he would like take it to the other planet to build in that other space. So it's kind of like that.
Mm-hmm.
I think they wanted like to say, okay, this may be the last Xevious game in a very long time, so let's just make it, you know, a bit for the fans or the people who are nerds. The kind of people who have played it for 10 years, like, here you have it.
I mean, 95, I mean, that's right at the kind of peak of a lot of this STG games really being played by hardcore players. Just in 96, you got...
Yeah, I mean, like, look at this. This is insane. Jeez.
So in 96 you got Grega being released, and then you got 98 Batrider coming out. I mean, just to give the rising examples, and this is the time when hardcore games were just—it was what it was, because these players in the arcades were just so intense.
And they're just the kind.
I mean, it's honestly a result of those players that we got such hard games.
Yeah, it's true, because after Street Fighter 2, like, the mainstream, you know, most players just went to play, you know, beat 'em ups and Street Fighter and the like. So the people who play shooters were like the big fans and the really, really hardcore. So
yeah.
So that's why we got like this kind of stuff, or Garriga, or... I mean, these were people who had played Gradius 3 and beat it, so...
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah.
What the hell? And looped it.
I looped it, like, wow.
And what the... Yeah, he's got a nice strategy for this boss too.
Like, actually, we are playing Xevious. There's a replay on the internet of people beating Xevious. Like, a pacifist run of Xevious. Like, they were so obsessed, they beat a shooting game without shooting. Like, wow.
Wow, like pacifist Xevious?
Yes.
Oh my gosh!
And it's on YouTube, like, you can Google it and say, like, pacifist Xevious, and it's insane.
Now, I think I only want to show this last stage here. I don't want to spoil the whole game, because the ending is... Yeah, the ending is fucking epic, but you guys should just see it on your own, either by somehow getting to the ending yourself or just seeing it yourself. But I don't want to spoil it, because it's fucking crazy cool. I don't want to spoil it though, but we'll just check out this last stage here. I think there's one more stage after this one. Actually, this might be the last stage.
Yeah, I think it's the last.
This is the last
now
one.
You get into the core of the ship.
Okay, stop it! Help! 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 We're not gonna show that. Stop it, Soda.
It's stop.
No spoilers, please.
Yeah, we're gonna let you guys see the ending of this game. It's fucking epic. I just get F word warranted. All right, so that's Xevious 3D. Really, really cool game. Insanely difficult. Even if you put it on easy, it's still insanely so hard.
Like, I mean, I can read this far on the game, and I'm like, what the hell is this? Like, they come you from behind, and there's only, like, two spaces for you? Wow.
Yeah. But yeah. Please get Xevious 3D/G on the PlayStation Network, because it's a great, great compilation. Okay, so we got one more game to look at, and I actually don't know really anything about this myself, but it's Xevious Resurrection, and this was released in I think 2009, 2009 on the PlayStation 3 as part of the Namco Museum Essentials. Now this is a 3D HD reboot of Xevious, so it'll be interesting to see kind of what they decide to do with it. So let's jump right into it then. 3, 2, 1, go. And this will be our final game that we cover.
Oh yeah, that synth. Actually, this reminds me of a lot of the Space Invaders, you know, like remix.
Oh, you mean, what's it called?
Space Invaders Extreme?
Or... Yeah, Extreme, yeah. So that's a new enemy type already, and obviously you have the HD graphics here. Kind of nice looking. Very shiny.
Shiny.
You got a shield, I see in the bottom left there. So you just replenish the shield. This is my first time seeing this, though.
Yeah, something interesting, like, now that we talk about the enemies and stuff, like, I think what makes, like, a Xevious enemy is that they are machines, so they are rigid. And the interesting part is how they interact with each other. Like, one enemy on its own is not a problem, like, or a group of enemies is not a problem. It's like, okay, you know that this laser guy, and then you have this guy that shoots from above, and if you separate them, they are very easy, but when they get mixed, now that's the difficult part.
That's a very good point. Some mixtures are deadly, for sure.
Yeah, and also, like, a lot of games, like, if you play Gradius, like, in Gradius, they took this, like, oh, you know, instead of making them, like, you know, this mixture, we are going to make them, like, more animal-like. You know, you play Gradius, they are, like, not intelligent, but they follow you around. They are, like, more alive.
Mm-hmm.
And here, they are, like, more mechanical, which I think, like, something very cool. Like, you know, here they feel like robots, and if you play Gradius, they feel more like robotic cockroaches or robotic crabs. Or
yeah, it hadn't really occurred to me too much about that.
Oh, but that's cool. Oh, he uses the shield to go through. Oh, and then replenishes the shield. There's a plot point in, like, No Con Kid, the Japanese drama, where you can, like, destroy the Bakura, you know?
Oh, man. No one destroys the Bakura.
Wow. I really want to check that series out. Like, there's a lot of Xevious stuff in it or something.
Yeah. That seems like a little Ikaruga influence, you know, use of, like, a shield.
It looks like something. Looks like the Ikaruga shield.
That boss warning reminded me of, like, Ikaruga.
Kind of a unique boss there. I don't know. a bit different. Whoa, entering the atmosphere. I was right. That was kind of cool. Enter the atmosphere now. Now you're flying very, very high above landscape back there. Oh yeah, it has like the kind of photographic landscapes back there. That's kind of neat, actually. Or satellite imagery, rather.
I mean, you have the satellite there. That's a satellite, right? It's supposed to be. Yeah, it is. You know, I think they are going like more. Yeah, you say like Ikaruga, it feels like that, like, you know, like more cinematic, so to speak. Like you come from the other space and you go down.
Yeah, this is definitely a bit more cinematic. Seems to be going for the kind of devious flow of like, kind of go here and do this, and kind of easing you into the new patterns and stuff.
Yeah, the ship speed looks a little bit slower, and the pacing slower, like the original Gradius. I mean, excuse me, original Xevious.
Yeah.
Now that's something like I mentioned like before the podcast and everything, and it was like, how many games end in Xevious? Like you have Xevious, you have Gradius, you have Darius. Sex is actually called Orius, so it also counts. It's like there are like, so there are like three or four like Greek franchises in this map, and they all have the same name. And then you have then Caladrius. Wow, there's like.
Oh, they brought back the original tune. We get to hear it on the stream finally.
Oh yeah.
It had to be on the stream at some point, right?
I'm asking the chat if they know of any other Aya shmups. You shmups.
One of my favorite appearances of the Xevious theme. So it's appeared in a lot of different things, and it's actually listed on the Wikipedia page. But one of my favorites was that in the arcade in Earthbound, you can hear the Xevious jingle going in the background. So somebody, maybe the late Iwata, perhaps, maybe he was a fan of Xevious.
Did you know that Itoi, you know, the writer for Airbound, he knows personally Masanobu.
Oh, he does.
They know each other. They are friends.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was probably,
I read it the other day.
That was probably something Itoi probably mentioned to the, you know, Tanaka and Suzuki. Hirokazu Tanaka and Kaichi Suzuki, the composers, I bet. Or something.
Yeah, like this guy actually like knows half of the industry right now. Interesting.
Itoi is the man.
So I want to interject a little bit of blurb when I was searching on Masanobu Endo. So
definitely,
in an article from the New York Times, it was published in 1985. They published this article on how Haagen-Dazs is taking over Tokyo, and they meet a Masanobu Endo, age 25 or 26, in Shibuya. So they actually interview him.
Haagen-Dazs interviews him, you're saying? Wait, who interviews him? Haagen-Dazs?
The New York Times at a Haagen-Dazs ice cream store.
Okay.
So he says, this is probably an STG Weekly exclusive. It reads, to be young and fashionable in Tokyo this summer is to be seen with a Haagen-Dazs ice cream scope. So, in the outside of one of them, young men in oversized linen jackets or black leather pants strut about, their tough look undermined by the ice cream cones in their hands. I guess people who chase after fashion like this ice cream, said Masanobu Endo, a 26-year-old computer games designer who hastened to say he was only eating Haagen-Dazs because he liked it. So there you have it from STG Weekly, this little gem posted from the New York Times about Masanobu
Endo. Yeah, he was not one to follow trends, clearly.
It just felt like You know, this is not an endorsement or anything. I just like the ice cream.
He's like, He's like, I'm not fashionable. I'm not saying I'm fashionable. I just like the ice cream.
I think it's nice that, going back to the Earthbound reference, I'm glad that it's actually in Earthbound, because Earthbound is one of these games that has one of the most unique worlds brought to gaming. So to have it Xevious, the game that actually introduced that idea of a game world, to have it represented in there like that. Just want to add that. Earthbound is like my favorite game, so I will talk about it every now and then.
Hey, no problem. That's a very, 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 very good game. Definitely in my top five.
I'm glad to hear it.
So, another blurb about Masanobu Endo. Where is he now? What is he doing? Well, he's actually at the Tokyo Polytechnic Institute and is a professor at their game development design department.
Excellent.
And I think I was looking at his Facebook page, I was able to find, using his secret hidden, and it's funny, to find his Facebook, you'll have to look under his secret name. So there's my soul tower for you guys to find out his Facebook.
Nice hints there, nice hints. Also, Scoops, Haagen-Dazs.
Scoops. Yeah, we're like the creepy Xevious fans who hold and creep on his Facebook profile.
Actually, that picture is from his Facebook profile that you see in the episode, and it's really great. You can see, like, his personality.
If you ever meet him in real life, you can go and tell him, I know what you were doing in August 1995. I was there.
Yeah, you could talk of like the ice cream, like, I saw you eating ice cream.
Soda, you can just loop whatever footage. You can bring us to the title page, Soda.
Yeah, I've done that.
Okay, great. So, yeah, guys, we talked a lot about Xevious. I'm really hoping that as the STG community in the West, we can recognize the series a little bit more. Because it had a huge, huge following in Japan, and even still today, but I think it's still underappreciated in the West, and just you guys got to give these games a try, and what better way than to get the PlayStation Network release for $10 on the PlayStation Network.
Yeah!
And play some
we're not sponsored.
Some Xevious Vanilla, some Super Xevious, some whatever. Also, we didn't talk about all the games in the series. There was some spin-offs and whatnot that we didn't get to, but you know, we could, it'd just take too long to get to all that stuff. So
I just want to say that Sulbalu is awesome, but you can't really play it because the emulation is terrible, but
yeah,
it's awesome. Like, I played in one exchange version of MAME, so yeah, that's also cool.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, basically what instigated this episode was I started playing some Xevious kind of like out of nowhere, and I just got hooked on it, and I was like, you know what, this shit's legit, so we gotta get it on the show. So hopefully you get everyone in. Hopefully y'all enjoyed it, and yeah, it was really good having you on here, Eric, twice also to talk about it, and really nice as the Xevious enthusiast.
No, but I really appreciate it. Like, I was so flattered. It was like, oh, Aqua Senpai, notice me.
Yes!
Yeah, because you were the only guy really talking to me about Xevious when I was fanboying about it on Twitter, yeah. So.
But, you know, like, it's like a kindred spirit thing, because back in the day, I was like, oh my god, Xevious, yeah, fuck Xevious, Xevious this. Like, you look at my Twitter feed, and it's like, one third Netrunner, one third Gradius, and one third between Xevious and the Tower of Druaga, and nobody cares about those games. So it's like,
yeah, oh boy. And yeah, thank you to any of the chat that chimed in with some little tips and whatnot, or little corrections and whatnot. Always appreciated there. But yeah,
thanks for coming on, Eric. Really appreciate you
coming in and
filling out a lot of I think you really communicated what it was like for Xevious to come out of nowhere and what how innovative it was and kind of opened our eyes to that.
Yeah.
Wow, thanks. But I really think, like, if I made, like, a top 5 of the most influential games ever made, like, Xevious would be there. Like, really, I can't think of... Like, just think about that, and just think it's, like, it's the game that really took gaming from, you know, single screens to, you know, like, level design. Like, all the games, like, I know that we are between, you know, as map fans, like, what we love is, like, level design, that kind of stuff. It's Xevious what created it. Like every single designer around, like they mentioned, oh, you know, one of the most influential games, like Xevious. Like, I have a list here, for example, Kojima for Metal Gear Solid 5. He said, like, you know, the big influence on this game is Xevious. And Jared's crazy, like, the guy who made Pac-Man C said Xevious, the guy who made a Siren and Gravity Rush also said Xevious. Yasumi Matsuno, which is the guy from Final Fantasy Tactics, also thinks it's one of the most influential games ever made.
It is.
So yeah, like for Japanese gaming, this is one of the most important games ever. And you know, another Endo game, which is the Tower of Druaga, which is really unknown in the West, and it was huge in Japan. It's also like really, really influential. So I think like he created like two extremely important games and they are like very underrated in the West. So I'm really happy you guys invited me here to talk about it.
Maybe we could have you on for an Awesome Game Replays episode for Tower of Druaga. That sounds like a good idea to me.
Yeah.
Wow.
In the future. You know, I like that.
I'm like nerding over right now. Like, yes, let's do this.
I hope to start playing it myself.
The passion.
Yeah. It's, I mean, you have basically all these, any game that is your favorite game, like, you basically have it, you actually have Xevious to thank for it. Just the fact that he created the game world, it's amazing. Like, it was probably the biggest jump at any point in gaming may have been at Xevious.
Yeah.
It may have been Xevious, or, I don't know, like, maybe, I know it's hard to say, but yeah, I mean, so that's going to do it, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out to this episode. I think we may have gotten quality options. We got 47 viewers today, so.
Nice.
Hopefully you guys got that quality. But yeah, not much else to say, but thank you so much, everyone. And
play Xevious.
You know, shooting games never die, et cetera, so yeah.
Yeah.
Take care,
everyone.
Shoot the core.
Shoot the core.
Andor Genesis must die.
All right. I feel like such a nerd right now.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I like we talk about like this 23 year old game for like way long. It's like, oh my god.
It's worth it though. I mean, more than anything, we could talk. I would love to talk about this for 2 hours, really, or maybe.
Yeah, we could
like
keep 3 hours. Going.
We could talk about all the designers who were influenced a lot, and then talk about just what exactly was it that, or, I don't know. Yeah, it just goes on and on. But yeah. Okay, so take care, everyone, and have a great day and/or night, and we will see you next time on STG Weekly or Awesome Game Replays.
See you next time.
Bye.